إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. All thanks and praise are due to Allah. We thank Him, we ask Him for His forgiveness, we seek in Him from the evil within ourselves. Whomsoever Allah guides will never be misled, and whomsoever Allah misguides will never be guided. I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah alone, and I bear witness that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his servant and messenger. O you who believe, fear Allah as he should be feared, and die not except in the state of Islam. Verily, the best faith is the book of Allah, and the best guidance is the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The worst matters are the matters of innovation, and every innovation is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is going to in hellfire. Oh, if you believe, keep your duty to Allah and fear Him and speak always the truth. He will direct you to the righteous good deeds and will forgive your sins. And whomsoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has indeed achieved a great achievement. Dear brothers and sisters, as we know, Quran is full of wisdom. I'm going to pick a topic today which is relevant to this day, that is Friday. We get Friday every once in a week, and there's a hadith about this surah and the significance of the surah. The surah that is related to Jummah is Surah Al-Kahf, wherein the Prophet ﷺ has mentioned about this surah that if somebody recites this surah, that person is going to have a life with him till the next week or the next Friday. So this surah is going to act as a light and guidance for you from one Friday to another Friday. Subhanallah. And again, there's another hadith which talks about this surah, that whoever is going to recite Surah Al-Kahf as it is revealed will have a light on the day of resurrection. Subhanallah Azim. Another important hadith about this surah is about the memorization of this surah. I know this surah is quite long. It has 110 verses, quite lengthy for any average Muslim to memorize. But again, if you can, that's a big reward for it. But at least the hadith says, try to recite repeatedly and memorize the first 10 ayats, 10 verses of this surah, and whoever is going to do that will be saved from the fitna of Dajjal. In another hadith, Prophet ﷺ mentions that about the significance of the last 10 ayats of this surah. So the first 10 ayats and the last 10 ayats have pretty much a big significance. So whoever is going to memorize, which is not a big deal, 10 ayats, alhamdulillah, everybody can do it. So we should make an effort and try to first of all read those ayahs. If we cannot do the full surah, at least those 10 ayahs. And Allah is the most forgiving and most giving. Because if you do 10 ayahs and the hadith is there, boom, you are safe. You are safe from the worst fitna that anybody could imagine on the face of this earth. That is the fitna of Dajjal. And we'll come to that later on in the khutbah as to what relationship Dajjal has with this surah. Okay? So again, the 10 ayahs, first 10 ayahs and the last 10 ayahs, we should try to read, understand and memorize. And we will do that inshallah. So again, I'll go through the surah as to what the surah is all about. If you look at the surah closely, after the first 10 ayahs, it has four major themes or four major narrations in the surah. Again, the first narration or the theme which is discussed is about the people of Kahf, by which the name of the surah is given. The name of the surah Kahf in Arabic means a cave in the mountain. And again, it talks about in the first narration what the story is related to the cave. So again, going back to the reference of in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the people of the cave. Again, Allah says in Holy Quran, we will relate their story to you with truth. They were young men who had iman in their Lord, and we increased them in guidance. SubhanAllah. Allah is saying here, we will relate their story to you with truth. They were young men who had iman in their heart, and we have increased them in guidance. So basically, they were a group of youngsters at the time when their ruler, this is probably the events after the Prophet Isa alayhi salam was not there in this world. And these people, these youngsters, were believing in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were not committing any shirk. They were trying to follow the monotheistic belief of Islam, that is in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ruler at the time was very cruel. So he decided that people are either going to do the pagan worship or follow his religion, or they will be prosecuted and killed. So he decided that, and he was going after all the people who were in his kingdom. So these youngsters, they decided, so they have two options basically, either to obey the king and lose their faith and worship whatever he is ordering them to do, or get ready to die. So they decided that they are not going to leave the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's deen. They were so firm on their iman that they decided that they are going to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and not worship anyone else other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is their option? So they decided that they should leave the town. They should leave the town and go somewhere else and do the worship for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they left the town, they fled from the town, and they went to the cave, having only sole trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't have any food, they didn't have any money, they didn't have any provision. They just decided that they are going to leave the town and get away from this person because he's going to kill them. So they wanted to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They went in the cave and Allah took care of them. Allah took care of them, and again the Quran testifies how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took care of them in a very miraculous way, in a very different way, where these people could not have even imagined when they were leaving the town and going and residing in that cave. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put them to the sleep. And again, the ayahs in the Quran tells that we directly send our mercy on them. That means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly helped them by putting them to the sleep. And sleep for not for one day, 2 days or 3 days. The sleep for years, so that they are saved from the fitna of this ruler who was trying to prosecute them. Look at the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is helping them when they have the trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So basically Allah saved them from this cruel ruler, and these people in the cave, they slept for hundreds of years. Mufassirin says, and again the Quran says 309 years. So they slept for 309 years, Allah took care of them. And again, there is a sign in this surah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about their appearance in the cave, how they were sitting, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was changing the sun for them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning how we saved them. So even nowadays science is proving that if you make a person lie on his back, and you can see it in the hospital. I being a physician, I have seen this closely with my eyes. But I don't think all of us have that kind of exposure. But just imagine a person is bedridden because he's old, he's ill, or he's in coma. If he's in one particular position, that particular person is going to have a pressure sore. That means his skin is going to break down because of the pressure on one particular area of his spine. So he's going to have a bed sore, what we call it in common terms, bed sore, all over his body. And that is good enough reason for a body to be destroyed. Let it be the person alive or dead, the bed sore forms and the infection goes in, and you eat away the bone and everything, and that person will be dead or finished after a couple of years. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, we saved them for 309 years, subhanAllah. And Allah mentions what he did to save their bodies as an ayah for us to understand and learn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the ayah, one of the ayahs in this great surah, that we turn them to their right, we turn them to their left. So here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly mentioning that Allah turned them right and left, subhanAllah. And that's what the modern technology does. When a patient is in the bed, you have a special bed which makes the patient turn. And if you don't do that, that patient is going to have bed sore and that patient is going to not survive. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has his way. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only just let them go to sleep, but made all the arrangements for them so that they don't have any bodily harm. Their bodies were preserved. They were preserved. Look at the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What he can do when he wants to do anything with us. So subhanAllah al-Azim, there's an ayah for us to ponder that they would turn, and it is mentioned in Quran 1400 years ago, when there was no technology of pressure sore or bed sore, there was no concept and there was no science at that time. But Quran is telling us, which is a sign, that is a word from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, the lessons to be learned from this narration in the Quran, this story of people of cave is not new to the Muslims. I mean to say, this story of the cave or people of the cave was revealed, and the Jews and the Christians, they know about this. So subhanAllah, how did they react when they were told the story of the cave? Instead of taking a lesson from it, they started pondering how many those people were. Some started saying there were three and the fourth was their dog. Some started saying there were five and the sixth was their dog. And some said there were seven and the eighth was their dog. And this is not, I'm telling something from my own. Quran says this. The people started talking about their number. What is there in the number? Let it be 3 or 5 or 10 or 11. Allah knows their number. Allah says, we know their number. And we believe in Allah. As a Muslim, we don't go and ponder on things which we are not supposed to go and do. Because Allah doesn't want it to. We need to learn the lesson what is there behind the story. If you go behind pondering the number game, who are there, how many of there, what was the dog with them or not, that is irrelevant to you. Look at their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the way they deal with the things when they were posed with the situations in their life. That is a lesson for us. That is a lesson to ponder upon and take a message. So instead of that, they started arguing about the things. And the same thing you can see in the Surah Al-Baqarah too. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Jews and the Yahud to the people of Musa to slaughter a cow, they did not listen in one order. They started arguing. They started asking questions as to which cow, what kind of cow, what color it should be. So the matter started becoming more and more complicated for them to a point that they found it so difficult to do it because they started asking questions and questions which were unnecessary and irrelevant. We learn from this as a Muslim, when an order comes from Allah or His Messenger Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we take it as it is. We don't use our intellectual brain or try to ponder why this, why that. No. We hear and we obey. That's what we are supposed to do as a Muslim because we know we should have that full trust. And when you have that full trust, Allah says, whoever is going to trust on me, I'll be sufficient for that person. It is our own weakness that we, it is our weakness of our iman that we don't have that kind of iman that we have, we can put our full faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, Allah is sufficient for us. Allah doesn't need any means. Allah can make things happen without means. In this example, is there a sign for us? There was no means for these people. They didn't have any provision, but they went in a cave and saying that Allah is going to take care of them, Allah did took care of them. So the lesson we learn is, first of all, anytime we pose with any situation in our lives, let it be good times or bad times, especially with the difficult situations in our life, difficulty with our health, difficulty with our finances, difficulty with our job, difficulty with our children. The first thing we are supposed to do is put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, put your iman and faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah is going to take care of you. And once you have that firm iman, like the people of Cave, Allah is going to take care of you. Allah will be sufficient for you, subhanAllah. And look at the way what the people of Cave did. They put the faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no doubt. And after that, they did not stop right there. They did something. They took an initiative, they took a step to run away from that town. They did not sit in that town saying that, oh no, Allah is going to take care of us because we are believing in Allah. They did some sort of means to try something and then Allah put barakah in that means. So anytime we have any situation, we have to put our effort. We believe in Allah, we put our trust in Allah, but at the same time, you do whatever best you could do in that particular situation and then have the faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah is going to take care of you. And not only that, they had the means, they went to the cave and they did not stop there. Again, the Quran says they made a dua, a very beautiful dua I want to share. Rabbana atina billadunka rahmatan wa hayyilana min amrina rashada. Which means, our Lord, give us mercy directly from you and open the way for us to write guidance in our situation. What a beautiful dua. I will repeat. Our Lord, give us mercy directly from you and open the way for us to the right guidance in our situation. So everybody's situation is different. They are asking for their situation. Look at the Quran. I mean to say how jame and how open the Quran is. So this same exact dua we can recite because our situation is different than the people of Cave. But as long as you are reciting the same dua and trying to follow the footstep what Allah has mentioned in this story, you will not be disappointed. Allah is not going to disappoint you. When He asks you, when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with His names, with the mention, what is mentioned in His book, Allah is not going to refuse to you. So having a belief in Allah, having full tawakkul in Allah is the first step. Doing the means, whatever we could in that particular situation is the second step. And the third step is asking Allah, making dua for that whatever situation you are in. And if it is good for you, it's going to happen for you. If it is not good for you, Allah knows the best and will learn. The coming of stories is going to tell you what is good for you, what is not good for you. This surah is so beautiful, it has so many lessons to learn, subhanAllah. And the next lesson, what we learn from this story is that the age is not a bar in Islam. Quran talks about these people of Kay, they are not a bunch of old people, they are a bunch of youngsters. The word youngsters is used in this context. Probably they were teenagers, I guess. So they were teenagers, but look at their iman. When you are young and if you have that kind of iman and aqidah and tawakkul, Allah is going to take care of you. Not necessarily that you need to have some gray hairs in your head, then you are close to Allah. To get close to Allah, you don't need the age. You can be young and still be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is your effort that's going to bring close to Allah. It is your iman and tawakkul and belief that's going to make you go close to Allah. Look at the honor these people were given. Even though they were a bunch of teenagers. We see teenagers, what can they do? They are still young. They cannot achieve much in life. You need to grow older to become something, right? Yeah, that's true. But look at the Islam. Look at the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with the thing. They are a bunch of youngsters. But Allah rose their level to such a high status that they are mentioned in the Quran. What an honor to be mentioned in the Quran. And they are going to be recited till the day of judgment. They will be remembered till the day of judgment. Look at the level Allah took them up because of their deeds, not because of the age. So again, age is not a factor. And it's a message for the youngsters over here that, we should strive and do our best because Allah, in the eyes of Allah, it is your amal, it is your iman that counts more, and it is your deeds that counts more than anything else. Moving forward, the other lesson I see from this story of the cave is that these people were asleep for a long period, like 300 some plus years. And when they woke up, what did they do? They didn't even know that they were asleep for 300 years. Because again, the Quran talks about their conversation. When they woke up from the sleep, they started talking and saying, we are hungry, we should get some food. So let's send somebody to the city so that they can bring some food for us. But again, they are talking to each other and saying, we should be very cautious. Why? They are still scared. They are thinking, they slept yesterday and they woke up today and the king and his people are still looking for them. So they are warning each other so that we should do it secretly. We should go out and buy some food, but it should be done secretly. Because they are worried about their lives. They are still thinking that somebody is hunting for them. They are looking for them, but they don't even know that they slept for 300 plus years. When they realize, they started telling each other, we must have slept for maybe a day or part of a day. That's what the ayah is telling. And again, in another place in Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, when the people are going to be raised on the day of resurrection, they are going to say what? Illa shiyatan aduhaha. Which is like, they are going to mention, we were there in this dunya for a period, for a very small period. Maybe a part of a day or less than a day. Subhanallah Azim. So this whole life of whatever we are living here, 50 years, 60 years, 70 years, maybe 100 years, Allah only. But when you rise on the day of resurrection, it's going to seem like a part of the day. Ashiyatan aduha. So as a lesson for us, this life is quite short. And if you don't take advantage of your time, you are missing the boat. And it will be too late by the time you are resurrected. You will be saying, what a loss. So try to use your time and try to get the most out from this life rather than going behind dunya. Because again, we talk about the dunya, the coming of narrations in the surah is talking about the wealth, and then it talks about the knowledge, and then it talks about the power in the last. So we'll talk in a little bit afterwards. Narration after the story of the people of cave in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about two people. These two people are basically their neighbors. One is a wealthy guy who has access to everything. He had two big gardens and and a river flowing in between the garden, and his gardeners were giving him a lot of fruits, and he was all blessed with children, family, wealth, you name it, he has everything. And he was proud of his wealth and his status. And the other guy, he was poor and he didn't have any wealth, and he was a believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this guy who has wealth and gardens was not a believer, he used to worship things other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and was also arrogant and boastful of his status and wealth. So the friend who was his neighbor used to remind this rich person, fear Allah, and if you are being arrogant and proudful of your wealth, Allah can take it away from you anytime. So be mindful and watchful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and don't be arrogant. But this person, he was heedless, like most of us, doesn't pay any attention. And he's like, you know, whatever, I have everything, why should I even worry about it? Subhanallah al-Azim. And exactly what happened was, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took everything in the blink of eye, and Allah ta'ala can do anything. So in a blink of eye, the next day, his gardens were destroyed, and there was, whatever he had basically was gone. Subhanallah al-Azim. And then he started regretting on things like, you know, I did something wrong. Then he started realizing his mistake, that he was wrong and he did not follow the advice of this neighbor or friend who has been reminding him of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do we learn from this narration in the Quran, in this Surah Al-Kahf? First of all, the worldly benefits or the worldly gains and the worldly wealth we have is something that is transient. Nobody knows how long you are going to be responsible for this wealth. Allah has given you money, cars, houses, whatever it is. We don't know how long it's going to last with us. There might be a situation, and we have seen times in the past too. Even in the history, you can see people who were rich and affluent at one time. For whatever reason, some calamity strikes them and they are in an opposite direction. They are poor and they don't have any means now. It happened to people in the past and we have seen with our own eyes. And Quran is testifying this with the event what is mentioned over here. So the lesson we learn is that, first of all, it is not something that is going to live with you forever. Say, if you even have it for whole of your life, but the moment you are going to die, you are losing everything. There is no way we are taking those bank balance, cards and whatever we have in this life with us to the grave. No. So the moment you die, that's it, finished. So even if it doesn't happen to you when you are alive, there is a good possibility that thing is coming. Because the moment you are dead, everything is as if you have lost everything, because everybody else is going to take care of that wealth, and you will be gone without anything. The second point which we learn from this is that you should not be proud and arrogant. Allah doesn't like that. Kibar and proud and arrogance is something Allah hates it. And anybody who has even a fraction of kibar or boastfulness will not be able to enter Jannah, because Allah has made haram Jannah for that person. So we should try to stay away from it and make sure that, you know, you are not proud and boastful of whatever Allah has blessed you. And the third thing we learn from this is that anybody who has been blessed with a lot of wealth and means doesn't mean that person is close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or Allah ta'ala is very happy with that person. No, not necessarily. Because in this example we see this person is blessed with so many things but is not even close and he has been destroyed. So that is not something, a criteria that should be considered when thinking that this person is happy or anything like that. And again, Allah says in the surah that what is with you runs out, but what is with Allah goes forever. So again, this ayah warned and reminded us that whatever we have is going to run out one day, either in our life or once we die. But whatever is there with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be there forever. So we should strive and do our best so that we save it for the life after here rather than saving for the life here. That doesn't mean that we should not worry about this life. Of course, we have to work and we have to kind of plan for our families, but to an extent that we should not get caught up with dunya, dunya and dunya and forgetting the akhirah. So that is the lesson that has been given in this chapter. The third thing in this surah is about Musa alayhi salam and Khidr alayhi salam. Here the story goes that Musa alayhi salam, somebody posed him a question and asked him, who is the most knowledgeable person? And he thought he is the most knowledgeable person. He said, yes, that is me, I am the most knowledgeable person. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Musa alayhi salam that you are not, there is someone else who is more knowledgeable than you. And Allah told Musa alayhi salam to meet Khidr alayhi salam so that he can learn from Khidr alayhi salam how much less he is in his knowledge. And then the Quran tells the detailed story as to how difficult was it for the Musa alayhi salam to meet Khidr alayhi salam. He was told to go in certain direction. There was some sign which he missed and he has to go back. Finally he met Khidr alayhi salam. But the lesson to learn here is what lessons the interaction, the dialogue between Khidr alayhi salam and the Musa alayhi salam is something to ponder upon. First of all, Khidr alayhi salam told Musa alayhi salam that you cannot be with me and learn. And here is Musa alayhi salam. He was a prophet of Allah and he wanted to learn because you know he is a student and he is trying to strive in the path of learning something. So he said, no, he is persistent. He is not giving up that easily. He is saying, no, I will stick around with you. Just tell me what I need to do. So the only request Khidr alayhi salam made was, you should not ask me any questions. No matter what I am doing, you keep your mouth shut and I will tell you whatever I need to tell you. Whenever the time comes, I will tell you. Okay, so the deal was made and the boat started traveling together. On the way, they came across a river or some kind of lake and they had to cross the lake. So there were a group of poor people who were driving their ships, basically transporting people from one end to another end. So both Musa alayhi salam and Khidr alayhi salam got a boat and then they were safely driven on the other side of the shore. And after getting off from the ship, Khidr alayhi salam did something very strange. Very peculiar. He made a big hole in the ship. And Musa alayhi salam was furious. These people, they treated us so well. They didn't even charge us for the services. And instead of being good to them and saying thank you and whatnot, you made a hole, you destroyed the ship. Seemingly, it looks like an odd behavior, right? Even for us, it seems like an odd behavior. And so is the Prophet of Allah, Musa alayhi salam. He's not going to keep quiet when he sees something going wrong or something being done in a way that is not supposed to be done. So he definitely asked a question. Then Khidr alayhi salam reminded, remember I told you not to ask me any questions? And if you ask, I cannot be with you. Then Musa alayhi salam said, okay, please forgive me. This was my mistake. And I'm not going to ask any more questions from here onwards. Okay, then they started going further. He found a boy who was playing. And Khidr alayhi salam got a knife and killed this boy. For no good reason, he killed a boy. Obviously, it looks like, why is he doing that? Why? So, the same thing Musa alayhi salam asked him, why did you kill a boy? He was an innocent boy, he was playing and you killed him. And Khidr alayhi salam reminded him again, you again break the contract. So, this time is the last warning, and if you do it again, that's it. You go on your way, I go on my way. Okay, this is my last chance, please forgive me. And they keep going further. They found a village. The people in that village were very mean, nasty, and they don't even care about the travelers. In those days, whenever people used to travel, you used to be hospitable to them and you kind of give them some food and some shelter. But these people were so mean and hostile that they don't even care about Musa alayhi salam and the Khidr alayhi salam. And then Khidr alayhi salam sees a wall that is falling and then he makes the wall upright. He does the job for them. And then they were moving. Then Musa alayhi salam asked, okay, those people were so mean and nasty. Why didn't you ask for some money for the work we did? We are not asking a favor now. These people are so mean, they are not going to do a favor to a traveler. Let's ask for some money so that you know we can eat something because they were obviously traveling, they were hungry. And then Khidr alayhi salam said, this is it. You have not been with your contract. Now I'll tell you the reasons why I did. And you go on your way, I go on my way. So he tells the reason why he did all those things. And again, Quran says too what Khidr alayhi salam has to say. First of all, Quran mentions that Khidr alayhi salam said, I'll read the translation. I did not do it with my own will and wish. It was a direct guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was following the orders. And the hikmah behind those orders, he explained to Musa alayhi salam, and that has been preserved in the Quran for us to ponder and read. The first reason why he made a hole in the boat was because there was a ruler on the other side who was taking away the boats. He was an unjust ruler and he used to just grab the boats and snatch away the boats from the people whoever he likes. So he wanted to help these poor people by making a hole so that you know if the boat is defective, that king is going to leave the boat alone and these people can have their means of livelihood so that they can survive. Seemingly it was looking like something bad was being done to them. But look at the hikmah, Allah has a broader plan for them. Instead of looking at that, it was looking like as if they are getting destroyed, their boat is now going to be lost and they cannot have their means of livelihood. But here Allah is protecting them from an oncoming, unseen future calamity. A lesson for us to learn. So we should never wonder and ponder like, you know, why this is happening to me? We might get sick, We might have financial loss, we might have a loss of, with our health, wealth, children, business, house, it could be anything. But never get disheartened, because you see in this example, there's a lesson for us. Seemingly the things are not in your favor. Seemingly it seems like something bad is being done. But in the eyes of Allah, Allah has a greater plan for us, which we don't, as a human being, we don't know. We don't have the ilm of ghaib. We don't know what is there in the future. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. Allah knows it. And Allah is the best planner for us. So if we understand this concept and apply it in our life, we'll not have problems. You'll never think like, why this is happening to me. Most of us, especially people who have weak iman, oh, why Allah is putting me through this test? Look at those disbelievers, they are being given this and that. Look at my neighbor who is not even practicing, who is not even coming to Salah, and is being blessed with this and this. Subhanallah al-Azim. You have to have your iman and taqwa, and it should be straightforward. And again, there are lessons in this surah to be learned. The next story is about the child being killed. The answer for that was because this child was going to grow and he in the future would be rebellious and would create more problem for their parents. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in khadar for them a better child. So this child was taken away from them. Again, it was Khidr alayhi salam was the means. So he was doing whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking him to do. And he also has the knowledge of future because Allah blessed him with that kind of knowledge. So he did whatever Allah showed him with the future knowledge. He did kill that boy for a reason that he was going to be a big troublemaker for the parents who were very righteous and who were believing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who were worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it was a higher for them getting rid of the son who's going to be a distraction and a troublemaker for them in this dunya, and hereafter Allah took care of that problem for them. The third thing, the wall was falling and they repaired it. That wall was, underneath that wall was a big treasure. And the treasure was belonging to the people. There were two orphans in that town and the treasure belonged to them because their father was righteous and he died and he hidden the treasure for them. And that wall was falling. So if that wall was not reconstructed, the people of the town would have snatched away the treasure of those orphans. So Allah wanted to save the treasure so that when the orphans grow up, they can have access to that treasure. So Allah was taking care of these orphans, and that's what He asked Khidr al-Islam to reconstruct the wall so that the treasure is safe and nobody has access to the treasure except those those orphans. When they grow older, they have access to it and they do whatever they need to do. And again, here is a lesson for us. If you are righteous, if you are trying to do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking you to do, Allah is not only going to take care of you, but your generations to come too. Because here the ayah is saying, the treasure belonged to orphans of a person who was righteous. So being righteous has a very long way, it has a very long impact. So we should strive our best to follow the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to steadfast on what Quran and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has asked us to do, because it's going to take us a very far in dunya and inshallah in akhirah too. I make dua and I ask Allah to guide us and give us the hidayah and give us the ability to practice the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ameen. Again, I have the second part. The khutbah is quite long, so we might need to continue at some other time. And the time is running out. So I make dua. May Allah guide us all and give us the hidayah to work and implement the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our day-to-day life. Allahumma azil Islam wa al-Muslimin wa azil shirka wa al-Mushrikeen. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد كما صليت على ابراهيم وعلى ال ابراهيم انك حميد مجيد ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.